We're in the book of 1 Corinthians, and we'll be picking up in chapter 4. So last week we talked about Paul reintroduced this teaching about the visions in the church. The church was being divided by different members saying, I am of Paul and I am of Apollos. And he concludes chapter 3 by saying that, you know, no more boasting about men. He says, all things are yours. And so he tells them that everything that is provided to them is yours. And I think what he's really talking about there is basically that the church, everything that God is providing is for the betterment and for the well-being of the church, whether it be Paul or Apollos or Cephas. And he goes on, basically includes everything. And so he picks up in chapter 4 and talks about his apostleship. We know that we can tell because later on in the book of 1 Corinthians and then again in 2 Corinthians, we'll kind of jump ahead briefly here. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 1 through 3, Paul talks about his apostleship. He says, chapter 9, verse 1, am I not free? Am I not an apostle? An apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? Are you not the result of my work in the Lord? Even though I may not be an apostle to others, surely I am to you, for you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. This is my defense to those who sit in judgment on me. And he goes on. So he's addressing later in chapter 9. It's obvious that some of the people in Corinth are questioning Paul's apostleship, and he addresses that a little bit as well here in chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. So then, so he's referring back to what he had just previously said in chapter 3. So then, men ought to regard us as servants of Christ and of those entrusted with the secret things of God. Now it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. I care very little if I am judged by you or by any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear, but that does not make me innocent. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait till the Lord comes. He will bring to light what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of men's hearts. At that time, each will receive his praise from God. So he says, he starts off saying, so then, you know, referring back to the reflecting of the previous statements in chapter 3, saying those entrusted, or, you know, in the word that's talked about here says those entrusted, or refers to servants, they would also, the words imply that, or would have also been used for like someone who is a house manager or a steward over some property. And so he compares those, he says, regard us, referring to himself and to Apollos, as servants who are entrusted with or house managers or stewards of the secret things of God. And secret things, those things that were not able to be discovered by human wisdom and only revealed by God. Then in verse 3, it says, I care very little if I am judged by you or by any human court. Indeed, I do not even judge myself. My conscience is clear, but that does not make me innocent. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait till the Lord comes. What kind of things is Paul talking about here as far as being judged? I don't think here it's like eternal judgment. I think Paul's talking about, you know, I think he's getting some criticism from the Corinthian church over something. He talks about here, he says, those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. So he's saying he and Apollos have been entrusted with the secrets of God, you know, as Paul as an apostle, and Apollos as another teacher of God's information and revelation to the new churches. He's saying we've been entrusted, and we have to, those who have been entrusted have to prove faithful. And so I think he's having some challenge about, I think, first of all, whether he's even should be considered an apostle or not, because he wasn't one of the original 12. I think there are also kind of, there are those in Corinth who are questioning whether he is being faithful or not. But Paul is saying, you know, he's receiving some accusations about his faithfulness. And how does Paul respond to these accusations about his faithfulness? Right. And so he's saying, you shouldn't be judging me. He says, I don't even judge myself. But he also makes a statement that I think is kind of interesting. And you kind of referred to it as, he says, even though my conscience is clear, that doesn't make me innocent. But he says, ultimately, God is the one who will judge me. What is the distinction between our conscience being clear and innocence? Paul says, even though my conscience is clear, I don't know of anything that I've done, but that doesn't make him innocent. So there's a distinction.
We all commit sins that we're not aware of. So that's not going to affect my conscience if I'm not aware of it. God's aware of it.
Right. Okay. And Jerry's saying, you know, there's things that we could do, sins that we could commit, and if we're not aware of them, then obviously our conscience is going to be clear because we're not aware that we have even done something wrong. But we're not innocent.
I think another part of that is that his understanding may not be complete either. Just like ours may not be complete. We may think that our conscience is not bothering us because we don't know enough.
Okay. And when you talk about that, you know, I think about Paul certainly had some insight that the rest of us don't, but did he have all knowledge at the same time? You know, and there's times when, you know, Paul was human as well, and he taught what God told him to teach. You know, did he have it all revealed to him at the same time? You know, maybe not. And so Paul was also in a position where, as far as he knew, he was doing everything that he had been instructed to by God. But it's possible, you know, he left that possibility that he could still be guilty of doing something that he wasn't, you know, doing something that was displeasing or that he wasn't aware of. And if Paul could be in that position, I think we could also be in that position. Does that mean that if we're guilty, I mean, there's a price for that sin? You know, and I think Paul is also, he's not really going into it and teaching it here, but it's supportive of other things that Paul teaches, is that, you know, our sin is covered by the blood of Christ as we're trying to do what he taught us to do. There may be things that sins that it covers that we're not aware of. Certainly, if we're aware of those, we need to repent of those. Yeah, Jerry. Okay.
He couldn't become an apostle after all the things he'd done.
Okay.
It would have been that problem in some people.
So Jerry's question is, could the Corinthians have been aware of Paul's history before he became a Christian, and where he was basically on campaigns to kill the Christians and imprison them, and he was pretty zealous for the Jews against the Christians. I'm not sure what his travels were before, and maybe somebody knows some of that better. I think just at least by word of mouth, you know, by historically, people knew who Paul was before he was a Christian, and there may be those who use that as an argument against, well, how could he then be an apostle if he was one of these who was so entrenched in punishing the Christians before he became converted? Let's move on, because we do have to stay on schedule. We've got to get through chapter 5 today so that Robert can pick it up in chapter 6 next week. So basically, Paul is saying to the Corinthians who are questioning his apostleship and his faithfulness is that God will judge in the end, and but his conscience is clear as far as what he is doing. Beginning in picking up in verse 6. Now, brothers, I have applied these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, so that you may learn from us the meaning of the saying, do not go beyond what is written. Then you will not take pride in one man over against another. For who makes you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did not receive it, why do you boast as though you did not? So Paul says he applies these things to himself and Apollos for your benefit. And so he says, this saying, do not go beyond what is written. So he says, if you do, you know, if you understand the meaning of that saying, do not go beyond what is written, then you will not take pride in one man over against another. So how is that saying, do not go beyond what is written, if they understand that and apply it, Paul says, it'll make it to where then they will not take pride in one man over another. How's that going to help them against this problem that they have where they say, I'm of Paul and I'm of the Cephas and I'm of Apollos?
If they don't exceed what is written, then they're all going to be saying the same thing. And they're not going to be having, you know, Apollos and Paul having different stories which make them more attractive to someone. You know, they're going to be telling the same thing.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, here we might have a little bit of a glimpse of what else was going on. Because if Apollos was teaching, you know, if he was getting revelation directly as a prophet or teaching from God, and Paul was, and I guess, you know, Apollos' teaching we know had some error in it because he was taken aside by Priscilla and Aquila. So I guess there's an opportunity for some error, and Paul is basically saying, you know, it all wasn't written at this time, so, but I think he's basically saying, if you stick to what the apostles are teaching, then you're not going to get so hung up in all of these different other avenues you can. You really have to focus on what are the apostles teaching, what did Christ teach? Okay. The stuff I was reading, it didn't say, you know, he's not quoting a passage here from the Old Testament. He's quoting a saying of don't exceed what is written. So, you know, not everything has been written. You know, he's in the process of, I mean, he's writing a letter at this time, but there's other things that are in the process of being written. I think that he's basically saying don't go beyond this, the base teaching that is coming from the apostles. You know, don't start expanding on it and deciding what you think will be better than what is being taught. At the end of this chapter, in verse 17, he says, for this reason I am sending to you Timothy, my son, whom I love, who is faithful in the Lord He will remind you of my way of life in Christ Jesus, which agrees with what I teach everywhere in every church. I think he's saying, you know, stick with what is written and the apostles' teaching. Don't start expanding on what you think might be better. So if we, in verse 7, I thought this segment was was interesting. For who makes you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did not receive it, why do you boast as though you did, as though you did not? So he's saying, basically, everything that we have comes from God. And so I think a lot of the Corinthians' issue was a pride issue. They were kind of coming up with, they either claiming that, hey, I came up with this idea when it really wasn't their idea, or they were making it different than what was being taught. Verse 8 through 13, Paul goes into a kind of an interesting segment here where he uses some irony and sarcasm. Verse 8, already you have all you want. Already you have become rich. You have become kings, and that without us. How I wish that you really had become kings so that we might be kings with you. For it seems to me that God has put us apostles on display at the end of the procession, like men condemned to die in the arena. We have been made a spectacle to the whole universe, to angels as well as to men. We are fools for Christ, but you are so wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are honored, we are dishonored. In this very hour, we go hungry and thirsty. We are in rags. We are brutally treated. We are homeless. We work hard with our own hands. When we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure it. When we are slandered, we answer kindly. Up to this moment, we have become the scum of the earth, the refuse of the world. So Paul goes into this dialogue, and some of what he's saying about the apostles is true. When he switches and starts talking about the attitude of the Corinthians, there's some sarcasm in there of best saying how they have exceeded, and already you have all you want. Already you've become rich. You've become kings, and that without us. So he's saying to the Corinthians, there is a problem there with the Corinthians about this arrogance and boasting and the things that they are thinking of themselves, of how highly they are thinking of themselves. And we'll see a little bit more even when we get into chapter 5 about the issue that they have with the one brother there who is says has his father's wife. And so Paul has this little section in verse 8 through 13 where he's talking about the haughtiness and the spiritual immaturity. You know, chapter 3, he talked about how they were immature and still needing milk. Here he goes in and compares kind of what they think they are to what they really are. And so there are some attitude problems that Paul is addressing. At the end of that, beginning in then 14, he says, I am not writing this to shame you, but to warn you as my dear children. So he's kind of trying to wake them up to the situation that they're in. In verse 15, even though you have 10,000 guardians in Christ, you do not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I became your father through the gospel. Therefore I urge you to imitate me. For this reason I am sending you Timothy, my son, whom I love, who is faithful in the Lord. He will remind you of my way of life in Christ Jesus, which agrees with what I teach everywhere in every church. In verse 18, some of you have become arrogant as if I were not coming to you, but I will come to you very soon if the Lord is willing, and then I will find out, not only how these arrogant people are talking, but what power they have. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. What do you prefer? Shall I come to you with a whip or in love and with a gentle spirit. So I think he's addressing one of the central problems that the Corinthian church has, and it's one of arrogancy and how they are approaching some of the teachings that Paul has left them with. And he talks here at the end about, you can kind of see how Paul views the Corinthian church. He does kind of view them as children to him, and it's children that, he sees as some responsibility as a father. He helped them, introduce them to the church, and they became Christians, and then he sees kind of them straying away, and he sees, you can see kind of his fatherly instincts coming out. And those of us who can remember, those situations, how would your father's going to get you straightened out one way or the other, and it's either, hey, how do you want this to happen? You want the easy way, or do you want the hard way? I don't know that Paul is really advocating here using a whip to straighten out those in the church, but I think what we see is his love for the church at Corinth, and he sees them as his children. And just as those of us who have been fathers, our interest is in getting our children straightened out, not seeing them continue down the path that they've chosen to go. Part of what this dialogue of Paul talks about, I think another thing that the Corinthians might have been dealing with is, what does God really want for them? Does God want them to be happy, rich, and successful? Is that his goal? And likewise, does he want us to be happy, rich, and successful? I think the answer to that is, not necessarily. He wants us to follow his direction. If happy, rich, and successful is how we are, then I think that's fine. But ultimately, he wants us to follow and do what he has been taught, what we have been taught, and what he has told us through his word. The comparisons that Paul gives in verse 8 through 13, he compares what's the situation that the apostles were in. If you are were the apostles happy, rich, and successful? No. I think the Corinthians were trying to, how do we kind of take this world we're living in and then take it, to them, I think they saw, how do I take advantage of this new situation, this grace that's made available to us through Christ? And we see a little bit of that, I think, coming through in chapter 5. So let's go on to chapter 5. Starts out and says, it is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that does not occur even among pagans. A man has his father's wife. So in that culture, this was a sexual immorality that wasn't even found among the pagans, that someone would have his father's wife. It could be his mother, but it's possibly more likely that his father has remarried and that it's his father's wife. Either way, it's still against the law that they were under. He says in verse 2, and you are proud. Shouldn't you rather have been filled with grief and have put out of your fellowship the man who did this? So who is proud? Who's he talking to when he says, you are proud? The congregation. So why is the congregation proud? What's the Corinthian church dealing with here that the church is proud?
The New American Standard says that they're not using the word proud.
What word do they use? It'd be in verse 2. Okay. So, proud, arrogant. What would cause the church as a whole to be proud and arrogant?
I think of it in terms of the opposite, that they're not in a negative way. Proud as in they're not ashamed, as they should be, because he goes on to explain, wouldn't they have rather put these people out? So I'm not sure it means proud in the sense that they're going around bragging about it, but proud in the sense that they're refusing to be ashamed of it. They just think it's okay.
Okay.
And that's arrogant.
Okay, and Jerry says they're accepting it. Okay.
Arrogancy and the grace, they think the grace is going to cover everything and it doesn't really matter what you do anymore.
Yeah.
And that your arrogance is in, look at us, we can do anything we want to do, we're still okay.
I think that's what it is. Now, because just when you read the rest of chapter 5 and we see some of the things that are happening, I think that's what is at the root of this, is that they're trying to, if you look at what is the culture that they're in, the town of Corinth is known as kind of the sexual immorality capital of the area. There's just all kinds of bad stuff going on there. Paul comes through and establishes the church, and I think they're struggling with this whole concept of grace. And just like in Romans chapter 6, where Paul starts that chapter saying, what shall we say then? Shall we sin all the more so the grace may increase? That's not the point. The point is not, let's get all the grace we can, how do we get all the grace we can? Let's sin all the more, and the grace of, because of Jesus' blood cleanses us. And so the more we sin, the more we're covered, and, I think some of that is just exactly that issue of trying to understand this concept of grace, and how am I supposed to behave when God's grace and the blood of Jesus' blood covers our sins? How are we supposed to behave when that's the situation? And I think that some of this pride and arrogance was coming from that misunderstanding of what is grace about. And I think they had become proud and arrogant of saying, well, look at us, we can have this situation, and the situation that Paul is addressing specifically is that there's here's one of the people in their congregation who has a relationship with his father's wife. So there's incest. And the church, not just this individual, is proud and arrogant about it, of look what we can do. So let me go ahead and just start again. It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and a kind that does not occur even among pagans. A man has his father's wife, and you are proud. Shouldn't you rather have been filled with grief and have put out of your fellowship the man who did this? Even though I am not physically present, I am with you in spirit, and I have already passed judgment on the one who did this, just as if I were present. When you are assembled in the name of our Lord Jesus, and I am with you in spirit, and the power of our Lord Jesus is present, hand this man over to Satan, so that the sinful nature may be destroyed and his spirit saved on the day of the Lord. Your boasting is not good. Don't you know that a little yeast works through the whole batch of dough? Get rid of the old yeast, that you may be a new batch without yeast, as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us keep the festival, not with the old yeast, the yeast of malice and wickedness, but with bread without yeast, the bread of sincerity and truth. I have written you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people, not at all meaning the people of this world who are immoral, or the greedy and swindlers or idolaters. In that case, you would have to leave this world. But now I am writing you that you must not associate with anyone who calls himself a brother, but is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater or a slanderer, a drunkard or a swindler. With such a man, do not even eat. What business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? Are you not to judge those inside? God will judge those outside. Expel the wicked man from among you. So first of all, he's given the church instruction that in the situation that they have where they know about and there's a man within the church, he's basically telling them to expel him or to disassociate with him. And so what is the purpose of that disassociation? Okay, it's to, you know, the desire is not to, you know, cause him to eternally go to hell. You know, the intent is, says in verse 5, hand this man over to Satan so that the sinful nature may be destroyed and his spirit saved on the day of the Lord. So the intent and desire is for him to turn and change his ways and come back into the body. Paul also addresses, you know, this issue of, you know, in verse 9, you know, I've written you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people. So it refers to a previous letter that Paul has written that we don't have a copy of or wasn't preserved. But he's basically addressing this issue of, you know, I told you not to associate with these different kinds of people. And what he's meaning there, he says, not at all meaning the people of this world who are immoral or the greedy or swindlers or idolaters. Because if you don't associate with them, you'd have to leave the world. They are in the world, and there's an awful lot of them in Corinth. So if you're not going to associate with any of those people, it's almost impossible. But he does make a distinction between how do you treat someone who is sinning, who's in the church, versus how do you interact and associate with people who are not in the church, who are not made that commitment to follow Christ, who are doing some of these things. And so the distinction that he's making is basically, if they're in the church, there's some activities that the church has to have in a disciplined role with the desire and with the motive of bringing those people back into the church, into a right relationship with God. There's also a relationship that we have with people who are not in the church, and he doesn't say become like them, but he says you can't avoid them. We still have to live the way that Christ wants us to live. Ms. Cindy? I think the definition of slander is someone who makes false statements about others. Negative false statements about others. And so, you know, and it is interesting in his list of, you know, these are things that in the church, you know, these are things that he says need to be addressed. And it's not just those who are sexually immoral, but it's greedy, idolater, slanderer, drunkard, swindler. Basically, I think as we know that those who are in the church are doing things that are outside of the behavior that we've been taught there are things that we need to do as a church to, with the desire and interest to turn them back to the path that's right. Yes.
I think it's also, there's kind of like a twofold purpose in removing them from among us. Not only to get them to turn back, but also to keep them out so that they don't love in the whole lump. Mm-hmm.
Right, and I agree. I think it is twofold there. He's saying, you know, he gives the analogy of the yeast earlier in that chapter, and he's saying you need to take what's causing this problem. It only is going to spread through the whole church and be a problem. So it is twofold. It's desire for that brother or sister to turn back, but it also is so that it doesn't spread through the church. Next week we'll pick up in chapter 6, and Robert will be leading our discussion through the month of January is already here. Thank you very much.